I treated my horn practice like problem solving, modeling approaches to learning I had picked up in school. I would solve a problem, only to experience the same problem again. I couldn't play high notes, I didn't think I would ever be able to trill, people told me I had a bad sound, and I was desperately jealous of all of those who made Allstate. When I was 18, I got rejected from all five music schools I applied to. I simply wasn't talented enough. I wasn't good enough to even study music. Northwestern University's music school turned me down, but their tech school gave me a scholarship, so I went to Edmonton and studied cognitive science and computer science while nobly struggling through 4 years of Mandarin Chinese. Fast forward. Today, at age 33, I play professionally on 3 continents, including 6 seasons with the Hong Kong Philharmonic, this past year playing about 14 weeks with San Francisco Symphony. In Florida this past season, I played principal horn on Burton 4, Grand Burton 1, Brahms 2, a lot of other masterworks. And I'm about to tour Europe with San Francisco Symphony right after this. This is exciting for me. What happened in these past 11 years, and how can I share the good stuff with you today? Well, through cognitive science, I learned that talent is built, not inborn. I spent 4 years studying how humans learn, and after that, I went to music school. Within 2 years of applying cognitive principles to horn performance, I'd won a full-time orchestral job. Since then, I've continued my explorations, branching out into Eastern approaches, via Wing Chun Kung Fu, shamanism, and yoga. Today, I consider myself a holistic artist in that I believe everything is connected. I use my music practice as a microcosm in which to cultivate overall self-mastery and greater life satisfaction. When I first conceived of this presentation, I thought I would present a linear overview, past, present, future of practice. However, rather than simply talking on these points, I have since decided to structure my presentation as a practice session that addresses the past, present, and future at multiple levels of scope. I will present most of the information I promised. However, it is organized in a fractal structure rather than linear. This may seem disorienting at first, so please remember to suspend your confusion if it happens. But that's all in the future. Let's get started. Welcome to the present moment. This is practice, right now. Words to live by. If you can make your life practice, there will be great, great effects. I define practice as the art and science of increasing skillfulness through deliberate action. Please save or write your questions for the final 5 minutes. Otherwise, just watch like a video. Enjoy. This is an experiential presentation. So let's start with the past, knowing where you're coming from. How do you organize your past of practice? The way that I organize it is I start by gathering my instrument, my materials, I set the environment. That's already been done. I review my goals, my existing frameworks. I ask why, how, what if, why not. And I warm up, which I define as remembering the choices that I've committed to. Let's review some goals. Today's goals for this practice session, for me, connect with other practicers to fuel synergy, team exploration of new ideas, universal refinement. By that, I mean if I get better, you get better. When you get better, I get better. We collectively get better when anybody improves. I demonstrate the application of some techniques that have been especially constructive in my life. Techniques include perspectives as well as actual activities. There's history awareness, presenting this fractal overview of the past, present, and future of practice, and actually practice together and build skill today during this presentation. So, what is fractal? I'm sure some of you are wondering. Fractals are mathematical constructs. They're described by a complex number formula. We can get into math after over years. They're recursive, which means that they're self-similar at multiple levels of scope, and they're infinite, which means like life, you can zoom in to smaller and smaller level of details within a finite container. So, let's take this triangle, A, B, C, vertices. If you embed that triangle inside, same vertices, A, B, and C, we we begin a process inside a finite container. This process can go infinitely, embedding deeper and deeper as we go. This is an example of a fractal. It's an iterated function system called Sierpinski's triangle. There's a lot of different kinds of fractals, but the basic idea is the same. Now we're going to start with a review, reviewing frameworks. What do we know about the past, present, and future of practice? What do I know? What do I think? There was a study of some baseball players. One group didn't practice at all, their batting, the control group. The next group hit 10 fastballs, hit 10 changeups, hit 10 curveballs in a row. That's group A. Group B didn't know what kind of pitch they were going to get. Fastball, fastball, changeup, fastball, curveball. No idea. Group A really grouped it. They threw it. By the 10th fastball, they felt great, and they were hitting much better than the first fastball. Group B didn't really have that experience. They were frustrated the entire time, every single practice session. But after 6 weeks, the coaches measured, or the researchers measured, how the batters compared. As you would guess, the control group didn't get any better. The mass practice group, 10 in a row, had not improved a whole lot. And the interleague practice had improved by leaps and bounds. In the past, certainly I was told, and maybe you were told, to repeat things multiple times in a row. And unfortunately, what that appears to do is just put it in short-term memory. Just like when you memorize a phone number, 542-3679. You guys can all spit that back, you can spit it back 10 times, but I guarantee that tomorrow it won't be there. Interleaved practice, on the other hand, is the process of spacing and using alternating repetition, just like the group B, so that we actually encode the new skills into long-term memory. What we want is recall of our skills, not just putting it in. We want to be able to get it out. In the future of practice, I believe that we'll be looking at artificial intelligence adaptive learning. Adaptive learning means a learning strategy that adapts to your progress and to your skill as it goes. There's a company called Newton, with K, in New York, that's working on this in educational frameworks, academic environments, and I think it's only a matter of time before we bring adaptive learning to a musical environment so that we're actually building our skills using artificial intelligence algorithms that identify the places that we need the most improvement and how to make those improvements most effectively and efficiently. In the past, there was a lot of self-talk, a lot of self-instruction. You see kids sitting on the floor, playing with their blocks, and they're talking to themselves. Put the Lego on top. That we brought into our practice, telling ourselves, don't miss this note, or maybe get this note. I'm going to do it. There's a lot of self-talk. However, in the presence of practice, there's a lot more emphasis on self-watching, just observing what's happening. Being present. In the future, I would like to see all those energies that are tied up with the ego be put into the actual execution of the activity, which I call no self. In the past, I was an unmusical practicer, technical for the sake of technique. In the present, probably all of us are having a growing awareness that music is important, but a lot of teachers say, play expressively, play musically. We try and create music. That's espressivo in a sense. But in the future, I think we're looking at end musical playing, which means that we're inside the music, almost being operated by the music in a flow state. In the past, it was a lot bad. I got yelled at a lot. That's terrible. You know who was standing by, but it wasn't me. And then I met Jeff, and Jeff introduced me. The complement of that, which is good, positive. And I learned to focus on what I want. I learned to identify what I like in my work playing. And I learned to identify what I love about music and practice it. However, as good as that is for the present, as balancing as that was for my skill and where I was coming from, in the future I believe we're headed towards wholeness, which is the integration of bad and good for whatever it is. This whole. In the past, I was avoidant of practice. I didn't want to practice stuff. And it showed. In the present, I've learned how to convince myself to practice through effortful enjoyment. I design my practice activities so that I enjoy them, and so they're based on my preferences and values. But in the future, I'm looking at natural, just natural practice. It's just going to happen. It'll be enjoyable and great. Asking, why, how, what, for today? Why? I love music. I like change. I like the path of mastery. Serve as a platform for universal development. How? Practice structures. What? Survey of techniques and practicing together is meditation. So what is practical meditation? You're going to keep your video, your attention on the video the entire time in the very center of the video. If your mind wanders, if your eyes wander, you're going to perform a three-step process called the bring-back process. The first step is to notice that your attention is wandering. The second is to perform a bring-back movement. The third is to bring your attention actually successfully to the video. And by the way, I will make this whole presentation available to anybody who wants it. And I'm a volunteer for 10 seconds. And raise hand, anybody volunteer? Yes, purple shirt.
Okay.
Will you just repeat to me the bring back steps so I'm sure that you guys are hearing it?
Notice, bring back, and attention.
Nailed it, thank you. Alright. So, bring back. We've got to decide on a deliberate physical movement that you're going to execute right now. What I'm going to do is not my headset. You might want to snap your fingers, raise your hand. Everybody, right now, please decide on a movement that you're going to perform that's easy and that you can do in the space that you have. When you got it, raise your hand so that I know you got the movement. You got it? All right, great. Let's try it. We'll just do about 30 seconds. Focus. Is that your movement to bring you back to attention?
I don't know.
It's not a movement to bring you back. It's just full attention on the video if you're tapping something. Good question. Let's talk about warm-up. Were you just warmed up for this task? If you were warmed up, would you perform better on it? Does warm-up automatically happen? You just did it 5 times, would you be warmed up for it? Why warm up deliberately? What if I could feel awesome and sound my best on the horn without warming up? If not, what's the minimum effective dose of warm-up? Blood moving as a metaphor for other systems. We've got to get blood into our lips, but also into our bodies. Energy and correct brain circuits move chi through our bodies. Warm-up is itself great practice. Martial arts uses forms, like steel and pow. So does music, arpeggios, scales, all sorts of forms. I'm going to demonstrate quickly, very quickly, a form that I think is useful for our meditation practice today. This is a chakra warm-up. I'm going to have to blow through this if we don't have a lot of time. But the chakras are energy centers in the body in Indian medicine. And they correspond, there's 7 of them. And there's 7 notes in the diatonic scale. Coincidence. We start with the root. This is home, resources, foundation, money, security, earth. Complementary emotions are security and fear. Locations at the very base of the spine, the perineum. Vowels, nice low vowel. What do these correlate to in horn playing? Fundamentals, long tones, where do I balance fear with extra security? For me, a task, high register tone. The foundation of this presentation is to share my experiences and perspectives to facilitate growth. So, to warm up, let's all feel the bottom of our feet. Where are they right now? Open them up. Feel your root center at the base of your spine. Just bring some awareness. What's at the bottom of your spine? Imagine it sinking deep into the earth in the direction of gravity. Settle down. Let's ground together. We're all connected to the earth. The second chakra is the sacral chakra. It deals with creativity and senses. Its element is water. shame and honor of the complementary emotions. A lot of those horn players. Around the belly button, where it's located, right here, in the center of the spine. This vowel is ooh, another one that we like to use for horn playing. Questions here, how do you experience your horn playing? Sensory awareness, creative attention. How alive does the spark of creativity and sensuality for you? Do you feel your lips? Can you enjoy the feeling of your lips? How are you sensual with your instrument? How are you sensual in your everyday? You can bring this once practiced in your life all the time to your whole life. For our warm-up, I don't think we have time to do sacral qigong, but let's just awaken our senses right now to the smell going on in the room, what you're seeing, what you're hearing, what you're feeling in your body. Where is your body in space? What are you aware of moving in the room? There's a lot more senses than six. Navel chakra. Personal power and self-esteem, another important one for players. Element of fire. Innocence and guilt are complementary emotions. Location is right in the solar plexus, the sternum, in the spine. The vowel is oh, another good one. How do you lead yourself when you're playing? Where does your power come from? Is discipline serving you in your performance practice? What kind of greater intentions are you bringing to your practice? Let's warm up and do some Taoist breathing real quick. I'm going to snap. You can breathe in for six, hold for two, out for seven, hold empty for two, and repeat in a cycle. Just begin whenever you're ready. I'm going to do it myself. Change of energy in the room. It's really a lot of personal power from that. Talk about the heart, love, connection, air, joy and grief are complementary emotions and locations in the chest. The vowel is ah. What do you love about horn and music? What do you love? Where do you feel that love in your body? Think of someone or something right now that you love intensely. Feel that in your heart, your love for that thing or person. Next energy center is the throat chakra. It deals with self-expression, communication. It's element of sound. Speaking, listening, and complimentary. Location is in the throat. Vowel is I. How can you speak your truth, including the dark parts about you? Keeping your throat open is important for enjoyable horn playing. Let's just honestly express to ourselves how we're feeling right now. Mind's eye is about visionary ideation and intuition. Its element is light. Ego and higher self are complements. Its location is the third eye, right here. Location, vowel is A, quite high. Vibrate that spot. What advice do you have for yourself in your plans? Come from here. Why practice non-reactivity? Why? Ask yourself, why not just react? Learning to listen to ourselves. Tuning into your higher self beyond emotion, merging subject and object. These are the functions of this center. For warm up, let's just spend like 30 seconds making some noise, buzzing, but listen to your thoughts as you do it. Put your whole attention on what's going on in your mind. Just do it. Let's start. Those are a couple thoughts. crown deals with consciousness and transcendence. Its element is space. No compliments here, just unity. Its location is at the top of your head, exactly the opposite of gravity. Bell is connecting with the divine, flowing with what is, trusting. We're warm up right now. Let's just sit for 30 seconds and empty. Not reactivity, whatever comes up. Just let it pass by. Welcome to the present moment.
Okay.
Being here and doing now. Mentalization. Other people call this visualization. I call it mentalization because we're imagining using all of our senses. All of our senses. Welcome to modern practice. We've got body wellness, Alexander technique, yoga, Wing Chun, nutrition, exercise. These are essential for functioning in today's competitive environments. Training drills, burp, hold dime, heart rate monitors. Tons of stuff that help us get objective data on how we're doing and help us develop ourselves away from the instrument. We've also got emotional resources, coaching, psychotherapy, Don Green, holotropic breathing, you name it, there's a million of them. And they're very important because we can't just exist with fear and shame and whatever we've been having in past generations of music and horn playing. It's time for a new era of musicianship. Practice techniques. The obstacle is the way. For me, that means identifying obstacles and going directly at them, treating them as my path rather than as things to be avoided. Spaced repetition, I've talked about with adaptive learning. Chunking is when you build larger structures out of things that already exist, like phrases out of notes, scales out of notes, and you build big structures. This is the proven path to expertise. Constructive distortion is when you play something louder, softer, slower, higher. Or, in modern times, you distort by improvising. Other ways of distorting what you're playing so that you can get to the essence of it is also what abstraction gives us when we try to get the essence of what we're looking at. These are all modern practices. Also, the plan. So I've got a plan for today's practice, which we're going to do in like 30 seconds. Perform a couple phrases of fractal meditation. We're going to drill the bring back movement. Practice triggering it improvisationally. Install it with the trigger. Form full fractal meditation, integrating new skills. Music meditation has a domain for practice, but I do this in my horn playing all the time. I'll drill something I want to do, then I practice triggering that event, then I install it mentally by visualizing myself doing it in the desired circumstance, and then I perform it. Alright, let's just take a little test of this exercise. Remember, if your attention wanders, perform a bring back movement, refocus to the center. Good taste of the exercise anyway. Did anybody's attention wander? No? My attention wandered.
Yeah.
Part of this is realizing when your attention is wandering. Some of the time you get caught up and go close. Alright, so what is your bring back movement? Remember? We're gonna have to skip this, but can I see everybody do it real quick just once? Oh, nice. Yeah? Great. Alright. Normally the way that I would drill this is by having a set of two sets of four reps, and I would do it once, mentalize myself doing it, do it once, mentalize it, do it once, mentalize it, do it once, mentalize it, take a break, go into constructive rest, or go into child's pose or something, do another set. The juxtaposition of doing it and imagining yourself doing it is very, very powerful. Alright, so we drilled it. Improvisational triggering of bring back movement. This is the way that I learned to install behaviors, is by triggering them in a different way first. So what I'm going to ask you to do is to focus where I point. When I point, do the bring back movement and focus where I point. I'm going to do it now, on command. And finally, the installation, which would be planting the intention to do the movement during meditation. Imagine yourself watching the video, simulate mental chatter, and then the desired response all in your mind. Not sure we have time to do that. Let's just practice for a minute for a second and see if you're any better than we started. Okay. Notice that I've been interleaving our practice of this. This presentation is a demonstration of the practice techniques. Now we're in the future. Know what you want. For me, I think of the future as composed of intention plus receptivity plus mystery. Karma yoga is behaving in alignment with your intentions without being attached to the outcome. I think that's important for mastery of the future. So, the intentions that I have for my practice are to feel good, mentally, physically, and emotionally, consolidate and integrate what I've just learned by making it sit, collect and store evidence of improvement, and identify any better ways to practice, you know, learn my lessons. So, let's talk about feeling good. Facilitating wellness. On the physical side first, I do physical intervention first, I release tension, I stretch whatever is shortened, ice and massage, meridian therapy, could be acupressure, acupuncture, laser light, whatever. It's working with the way that our body moves on meridians. Emotional wellness, identifying any emotions that need clearing. I was frustrated for like 15, 16 years straight with porn play because I didn't know how to empathize with what I was feeling and I didn't know how to reframe it. So once I learned how to really identify what I was feeling and clear it, that led to a lot more wellness on my part and accelerated progress in my plan. Finally, there's mental wellness, finding ways to appreciate your practice and establish what you learned and the progress that you made. If you want to get sick, I really want to get to the interesting future stuff though, so we'll talk about this later. Grab a handout on your way out if you want. So tracking progress is important. Here we could have tracked our eye movements by videoing it. Track the time spent practicing, that kind of thing. And improving our practice is the next important thing. A little bit out of time. Anybody who wants to stay, I'm going to quickly summarize what I think is the future of practice. We've got video games, practice logs, and other places. We've got beta blockers, nootropics, psilocybin, entheogens, DMA, and nanopharmacology. All of these are going to radically transform how we practice. All right, so what I've learned is that cultivating talent is my personal responsibility. Why practice, how to practice, what am I practicing? Very important. In the past, we've had deliberate practice for a long time. Learn from your own past. In the present, science, tech, and cultural evolution are moving us forward. In the future, use your intentions to set your own future. It's the most important thing. Take everything I say with a grain of salt. In theory, there's no difference between theory and practice there is. That's a yogi. Thanks for watching. What is the past, present, and future of your practice? There's handouts if you want to grab on the way out. And thank you very much.